Hello, I'm going to show you how we can significantly speed up our Node.js application by implementing Redis caching. So what we're going to do is first we are going to create a simple and basic API endpoint where we're going to fetch the profile information for our user. So we are going to receive user ID and then we're going to fetch the user information from the database and then send back the information after processing. And then the next step, we are going to implement Redis caching. So instead of just when the user sends the user ID, instead of fetching the information from the database immediately, what we're going to do is we are going to check in the cache server on the Redis server. If we do have a copy of these information, we are going to fetch it in a very fast speed, because as you know, Redis save the information in the RAM or in the memory. So writing or reading information from the memory is very fast, very, very fast compared to writing data on the hard drive, which most of the traditional databases does. So what we're going to do is we are going to try to fetch the information from the Redis server. If we found the information, we are going to just hand it to the client. If you do not have the information, we are going to fall back to the default scenario where we're going to fetch the information from the database. And after we fetch the information from the database, before handing it to the user, we are going to take a copy of these information, and then we are going to save it or cache it on the Redis server, so the subsequent requests will be served from the cache without ever hitting the database again. Then I will show you how to invalidate cache, because what if the user has updated some piece of information about himself? If he updated his username, his bio or something, we will have to invalidate the cache, so we make sure that the data is always up to date. By the end of this video, you will see how we reduced the load on our database and we made our API significantly faster, probably 100 times faster than before. So what I'm gonna do now is I will init an npm project. I will say npm init, and then we are going to install the three libraries we're gonna need. We're gonna install Express, and then MySQL2, and then the Redis library. And here you have to distinguish between two things. First, we have a Redis server. This is the server on which we store all the information. It is usually a cloud server. And then we have the Redis client, or the SDK, or the library that we are using to communicate and connect to the Redis server. In this video, I'm not going to use a cloud server. You can get your own cloud server from AWS, Google Cloud, or any cloud provider. But in that video, I'm going to use my own. I have installed my own server on my local machine. So we have installed the libraries. I will create an index.js, and here I will, let's just test our server. I will say const, let me first import the Express, and here I will, actually AI is helping me, app equal, okay. So we have the Express, and now we are listening on the port. Now all good. Now let me create an endpoint. So actually AI is doing so very good job. So here I have the user slash ID, and here I'm receiving the ID. Let's just display a hello world, and let me start the server npm. Actually, I still have not installed in NodeMon. I will install save dev, and then npm run dev. Actually, I have still not defined the scripts, so I'm going to say start dev. Now let's again execute run dev, and now let's go to the browser and refresh the page. Okay, now we have a hello world. Now let's go back to our code in the index. I will create SQL connect to connect to the database. I will .js. Now I will import create full from database, and then now we have the SQL client class. So I'm going to go back and create fetch profile.js. And here I'm going to import SQL client. And here we are querying the database. We are asking the database to give us the user details for that user ID. And here we can say const user details equal row 0. And then we're going to return the user details. And here in the index, we will send response.json await, or actually let's create another variable. I'm going to say user details and response.json.user details. Let's go to the browser and let's check. Fetch profile is not defined. That is because I did not import fetch profile. Now let's go back to the browser, refresh. Now we have all the information for the user. That is so much information. So let's create a function that filter out most of the unnecessary information and only keep the ones that we need. So I'm gonna need the username and user full name, user email. So let me copy that and go in the fetch profile. I will create a function, filter information, user details, username, user full name, email. Okay, all good. Now I will say user filtered details equal filter information, and then I'm going to pass the full user details, and the function now is going to return only that information that I want. And let's return the filtered details, and now let's refresh the browser. Okay, now we have only the information that we need. So till now, everything is basic and simple. That is the traditional endpoint you're gonna build. It just take the user ID and fetch information from the database and just filter out the information and just display it in a JSON format. So what we're gonna do now is we are going to put, as I said, a caching layer above our API. So when the request come, instead of going immediately and checking from the database, we are going to check if we do have the information already cached on the Redis cache. So I'm going to create a file. I'm going to call it Redis connect .js. I'm going to import create client, and we have created the client. As I said, if you have a cloud server from a cloud provider, you will have to put your host or the IP in that place. But because I'm using my local host server, so I have the local host in here. And here we are just confirming. We say on error, give me an error message. Otherwise, give me a success message. And then we are exporting the Redis class. So let me first start the Redis server. I will say Redis server. Now we have the server running. Now let's go to the index, and then we are going to import the Redis client, and let's confirm that it works. Let's go in the browser. Okay, now let's see in the log. It says Redis client connected. Now we have connected to the server successfully. So I'm going to go take a copy from that and going to fetch profile. Now we imported the Redis client, and here what we're going to do is first we are going to define the cache key. Because now every piece of information you're going to save on the Redis server, you have to give it a name, just like in the traditional database. When you save a user ID, a user, you give it an ID. So you use that ID as an address for that user. Now the same work, the same happened on Redis. You have to give it a name, and in that name you have to use the ID. So I'm using the user ID in here, and in that place you have to put, it's like part of the best practices is to use the type or the category for that information. So if you're saving a product information, you will say product. If you're saving a post information, you say a post. So you know what kind of information inside that piece of information. So I'm going to remove that. I'm going to return it into profile, and here you can use a hyphen, you can use underscore, but I prefer to use the colon. And what we're saying here is we are trying to fetch the information from the server. We are using a get function that comes with the Redis class. That function go to the server and fetch information from the server. And here we have an if statement. We say if we do have the cached profile information, we can say cache hit. We know the cache is hit. We receive the information from the cache. Otherwise, it's going to fall back into that part of the code. So what I'm going to do here is first we are going to decode the information we've got from the cache. We are going to parse the information, and now we have the decoded is an object. We have decoded the JSON code. So now we have an object, and now we are going to add another property, additional property to the object, so we know that that information is coming from the cache. And now we are returning the decoded information, and in the index, we are going to again send the information. Now, if we execute or if we browse the file, it will always come fall back to that part, because we have nothing that saved the information on the Redis server. So what we're gonna do here is we are going to say const save equal await Redis client. We are going to use the Redis class to set the information. In the first parameter, we set the cache key. In the second parameter, this is the time to live or the TTL. And here we set the information. We stringify the information and pass it in that parameter. Now, what is the TTL or time to live? This is for how long your data is going to persist on the server. So if you put a number here, this is the number in seconds. After that number of seconds, your key, your information is going to be removed from the server. The reason for that, you can just avoid it. You can just use the normal set function and you remove that TTL. But it's preferred to always put number in here, because sometimes there is a user information that is probably queried only once, and for a long time nobody else will ever fetch this information. It's redundant to keep on the server. So that information is going to be removed. You can put like 3 days, 5 days, or whatever. And after that period of time, that information is going to be removed. And if someone, if somebody else ever query that information again, it will be recreated on the cache server. So let's put here, like, I like to make it 1 day. So I'm going to say 24 multiplied by 60 and multiplied by another 60. And now we save the information. So I'm going to save the file, and let me confirm everything is correct. Okay, now let's go in the browser. Now if I refresh, now we don't see the cache equal one. We don't see, because the data is coming from the database. But if we refresh, we see cache equal one. That means the data is coming from the cache. Now there is something crucial to learn. It's the cache invalidation, because what if the user update his information in the database, update his full name or username in the database? Now the data will not be updated on the cache. Now let me show you, let's create another endpoint. Let me go back to the code. I will say, let me go back in the index. I will say app.post user ID. So now we have created additional endpoint to update the user full name. So here we are receiving the user ID from the parameter, and here we are receiving the new username, and we have the update query. It updates the user full name, and we executing the query and providing the necessary data, the new username and the user ID, and we display a success message. So I will try to open the postman, and here I will pass the information, new user, new user name is, let's put Joan, and then I'm going to send the request. Okay, now we have an error, SQL client. I have not imported the SQL client. So let's go back to the postman. I will send the request. Now the user updates successfully. Now let's go to the browser. If we refresh, the name will remain the same. That is because we have not updated the cache. We have updated the database, but we have not updated the cache. So there are two ways to update the cache. The first method is the hard method, which is updating the cache in here. So you retrieve the cache and then you parse or decode the cache, the JSON that you receive into an object, and you modify the object and then encode it again and then save it again. That is a very long path and very hard, and it usually lead to mistakes and errors. But the most easy and simple way to do it just to remove the cache. So we're gonna define, as you see, the AI is suggesting it. So we define the cache key and then we remove the cache key. And then next time the fetch profile will recreate the cache again. It will repeat the same cycle. So I want you to take notice about something. That name cache key must be exactly the same like the one in the fetch profile. And if you have a bug or a problem, you always check if there is a typo in that, because it happened. It always happens that you miss a letter or something and things doesn't unfold according to you, what you're expecting. So let me again send from the postman, and let's refresh the page. Again, now you see the name has changed to John, and here the cache has disappeared because now the information is coming from the SQL, from the database. But if we refresh again, we see cache equal one. Now you have implemented the Redis caching in your API endpoint, and I highly suggest that you implement that same technique in all your endpoints. That will make your app much faster, and you reduce the load on your database. And it will become very cheap because, again, reading information from the cache is much cheaper compared to reading data from the database. Thank you very much and happy coding.